Hi, and welcome to the World Beyond Belief. My name is Paul Marco, and this is an incredibly special event we're having here. This is a targeted individual forum. This might end up being an ongoing thing, but right now we have fascinating people and fascinating subjects to talk about. The reason we're doing this is to for three target populations. One is to introduce the general public, the awakening public, to actually what's happening, see your tax dollars at work, what's happening to targeted individuals. Now, I know we're all targeted by chemtrails, we're all targeted by energy weapons, microwaves, GMOs, but these people are specially targeted. They were called out for what I think the stupidest reasons, but they're under intense asymmetric warfare. They're being warred upon by the various intelligence agencies. So I think the general public needs to know that, and the more they know, the stronger they'll be in trying to get rid of this hoax. The second population that I think this is important for are the TIs in general. We've known from interviewing TIs over the last 6 or 8 months that there's millions of them out there, and they're targeted for, again, sometimes maybe relevant reasons, but mostly stupid reasons, and the targeting is super, super cruel. And during their targeted, they're gaslighted. They're made to feel crazy because these agencies do things that when you tell them about it, it makes them sound crazy. I want the TIs to feel like they're in a group. They're not crazy. We know they're not crazy, and we're trying to do something about it, and you're going to hear about what's going on about it today. The third group are the perps, the people that are doing this. If you have some humanity left in you, wake up. Stop doing this. It's not worth money to do this to your fellow human beings. Think about it. And if you have some guts, come out and talk about it. So those are the three groups that we're kind of hoping listens to this and gets something out of it. Today we have amazing guests, three amazing women that are TIs. We have Dr. Katherine Horton. She's an Oxford-educated particle scientist, very intelligent, very sensitive, very personable, very action-oriented person. She got put into the program because she was monitoring closely a court proceedings in London. Oh my God, we can't do that. And then we have Ramola D. She's an award-winning author and thinker. She got put into the program because she complained that her after-school care was costing $5 an hour. And that was just way over the line. So she got put into this horrible program, and she's been it ever since. The third person is Karen Stewart. Now, Karen, I'm not as familiar with as I am the other two women, but I'm going to read a little bit of her bio. Karen Stewart was born in the 50s, first child of an American Air Force officer and his wife. She graduated college and applied for a job and was hired by the National Security Agency as an intelligence analyst in 1982. After an extensive background check that included IQ, psychological fitness, and skills testing for such things as writing skills and foreign language aptitude, she was hired. In 2010, after 28 years, she was forced out of NSA for asking the NSA Inspector General, George Ellard, to investigate the allegations of theft of officership credit and the resulting double promotion for a six-month series of intelligence reports, which she wrote, that were estimated to have saved 2,000 or more American military lives in Iraq. So she complained about an authorship, and she ended up in the targeted individual program. The reason I wanted to say that is because none of us are immune from this program. It's all encompassing, and It's amazing. Okay, administratively, we do have a chat room going on for people to call in. Mindy is here with me. She's going to be helping the chat room. I'm not sure we'll be able to get much from the chat room into the conversation. We're just new at this, and we'll do what we can. So, without further ado.
You may introduce yourself.
Oh, yeah, I'm Paul Marco. I'm always on World Beyond Belief. I'm the only guy that'll be here. Okay, anyway, let's start off. Karen, would you like to start? You can unmute your mic and tell us about what went on, or talk about your wonderful day yesterday.
No, Katherine. Oh,
you said Katherine. I'm sorry, Katherine. Katherine, if you'd like to unmute your mic and come on in. Let's get the ball rolling.
Okay, so yes, I guess we've got so much to discuss. But actually, before I get onto this, maybe now that we are on the introduction, maybe what we should start with is also how you know, the three of us got together and what we're doing now, because essentially it is very, very special to have us all, you know, have the opportunity for all three of us to, you know, to be on your call. Because we just recently formed a joint investigation group, an international joint investigation group, which we would like to publicly announce. So Karen Stewart, Ramola D, and myself, together with Dr. Millicent Black, who's also in the US, and Melanie Richan, who's in Belgium, we decided that what we really have to do is a joint investigation that spans the globe. So this is why we essentially have, you know, Melanie from Belgium, myself in Switzerland, and Karen, Ramola, and Millicent in the US. Because we realized that what we're essentially in right now is a situation whereby, to me at least, it seems that all the police forces are suspended. So what we have to do is assemble our own private investigation teams. And we realized that we have all the ingredients that we need, you know. I mean, Karen is an NSA analyst. So Ramola is a human rights activist and journalist and author. Dr. Millicent Black spent years, and Melanie Richan herself spent years researching the technology that has been implanted in them and how it actually interfaces. And these ladies have so many years of experience and background and top qualifications that transcend most qualifications that the police can have. You know, I mean, if I look at Millicent and Melanie, through the many implants that they have, and which are hugely painful and crippling, they have much more detailed experience of military technology than a lot of the military guys who maybe, you know, learned about this in lectures. So they know what it's like, you know, to be have that applied to you. So Millicent and Melanie can't be with us today, but you know, it's really all five of us. And what we're trying to do together is put together the research that these ladies have done. It's also what we'd like to do is put it out so that victims can essentially download, for example, a reference list and download the background and maybe also victim testimonies, which they can take to the police and to the courts as they see fit themselves. So this is what we're working on. And also what we're working on is actually analyzing where are the victims, what has happened to them, what has been done to them, and how to help them. What we'd like to do is, we're not getting in the way of police investigations here. What we would like to do is assist police investigations all around the world, because this is a global problem. And also we realize that we have to work together, because every single one of us is being brutally attacked. Every single one of us has survived assassination attempts, pretty much, and then assaults. And this is extremely dangerous. And if we're just on our own, we realize we can be picked off and we can be called mad. But now it's very hard to discredit five people, you know, all with these credentials and this, you know, it's incredibly high integrity that all of these ladies have. And I'm just so proud to actually be in a team with them. So, you know, this is essentially what this is the, you know, the opening, you know, of or the opening, what's it called, interview or call with the joint investigation team. And what we're really hoping to do is put something into place that benefits the victim communities wherever they are in the world. So whatever we're doing, it's not specific to America, Belgium, or Switzerland. It's meant to be neutral and just benefiting the victims as best as we can. So this is essentially the introduction. And then we have been extremely busy. So every single one of us has been working flat out, trying to, you know, help victims. We have cases that are truly horrific, where people are being tortured. And we have this feeling of helplessness that we know who's doing it. We know how they're doing it. We're talking to all the police and, you know, senior police and federal level law enforcement. And we seem to be unable to stop these abuses, which are premeditated. It's absolutely incredible. So we are really in a sort of twilight zone right now. And we realized we have to use extraordinary measures in this extraordinary situation. I will not speak for the other ladies. They can report on their activities. But, suffice to say that it started with fireworks when Ramola, you know, sent this memorandum to Donald Trump, and we're trying to follow up from that, which was, I think, a perfect coup. You know, she can tell us about the aftermath. So since then, I was also trying to get through to the officials, and what I'm trying to do is essentially go step by step through the system, trying to uncover where the corrupt bits are and expose them. And do it as publicly as possible, and report back to the public via YouTube videos about every step, so that first of all people can see what I'm doing. Also, I want it to be such that all the intelligence agencies know exactly what I'm doing at every one point in time, because I realize for them it's a pretty big issue. I mean, we are uncovering huge crimes that they've committed. Of course, they're nervous about it. Of course, they want to do damage containment or whatever they call it. But at the same time, they have to accept that these are crimes against humanity and we have to roll them up. So I think the fairest thing to do is that there are no surprises. We're not stabbing anybody in the back. We're just going to do a public investigation. We're going to find the victims publicly and help them publicly in a slow manner. So this is why I decided to just, you know, do it through these YouTube videos and keep everybody informed. And I also want the victims to see that if they experience any sort of difficulties and they come up against corruption, it's very easy to be disheartened, but one mustn't be. That's just the first step. In a sense, one has now reached the battle line. This is the corruption we are trying to fight. So as soon as you're up against a corrupt official, you mustn't just panic and freak out, you know, get angry. You have to push back. It's very important for me to also report about all the things that happened to me, so that people think, oh, that's normal and that's okay. And sometimes, for example, yesterday, by pure chance, you know, or providence or whatever it is, you know, things arrange themselves in the most beautiful fashion I couldn't have done myself. And then you realize the other side screws up as often as well, you know. So this is the big picture, and what happened yesterday, and I put out the YouTube video about that, is that I was trying to get help here from the German ambassador in Switzerland, and he just blocked. He's been blocking for an entire year. And yesterday I drove again to the embassy for the third time this week, and again, there was no one there to speak to, and I was turned away from the embassy. And I was so upset about this. And then this is after I've communicated with them by email. So they don't reply to email, which is why I went there. So being then turned away physically when you've traveled from Zurich to Bern is frustrating. And I thought, right, that's it. I've been attacked brutally. I'm going to upload the videos about how I'm being shot into in bed. You can see that on measuring devices. It's horrific. And I was so angry. I thought, right, I'm going to talk to the military police now. And with them, I've also been in touch via phone. So I drove straight to the military HQ. And actually, I almost encourage people to just go for it, because we are a democracy still on paper. So we mustn't be afraid of our own institutions, you know. So when we are scared to go to the police with a problem with crime, that's not a natural state. Right. So I thought, right, I should, you know, take my own medicine here and, you know, practice what I preach. So I went straight to the military HQ, and I said I would like to talk to somebody from the military police. And in the YouTube video, I explain in greatest detail what happened. But essentially, they first tried to fob me off. So one guy came down and he wanted to talk to me in the car park. It was hilarious. I mean, what utter disdain for victims, you know, to just guide you out. I mean, this is a high security compound, so fair enough, you know, but already the porter's lodge would have been warmer and nicer, you know. It was like an airlock thing where you go inside, then going out into the car park. It was ridiculous, you know. So already contempt number one. But then fortunately, and this is how you can see how evil sometimes cancels evil, because my gang stalkers had essentially followed me all the way into the car park, and they were very prominent outside military HQ. And when this guy took me outside, I said, look, I've got a folder, and I pointed at the black folder, and I said, I would like to discuss these matters with you in private. And now, essentially, we're in the car park. So look at this person there. They're clearly, you know, an agent. So, you know, do you really want to discuss it with them? So anyway, and then I was taken inside, and it turned out that actually the person I was talking to, by his own admission, was actually an agent of the Swiss intelligence agency, and he was gloating to me that he was really high up and so on. But then what I said is, okay, do you want to have, you know, this case file? And he listened to everything I said. We spoke for over an hour. And in the end, he accepted my case file. And by doing that, and by his own admission, being an agent of Swiss intelligence, he essentially, for the first time, allowed me to have proof that now the Swiss intelligence agency knows in greatest detail. So, you know, I managed to talk to them for an hour. That was a huge breakthrough. Because now everything that happens to me, I can point to Swiss intelligence and I can say, well, I told you that I'm wrongfully being stalked. I told you I'm being attacked in my own flat by these military weapons. You have all the means. You've got your sovereignty. This is your territory. And ergo, I have got public culpability and public liability, which he himself generated. And what a huge breakthrough this is, one only understands when you've seen how I was bounced off all these agencies and none of them wanted to give me a case file or a case report. So to have this from Swiss intelligence and by his own admission, a very high ranking officer, it's like, yes, can be done. So that's the report from me. That's the biggest breakthrough through yesterday.
It's my understanding. That every law enforcement agency. We're getting a lot. That's another prosecute crimes against humanity.
Sorry, you were just breaking up. So you said that every law enforcement agency has the authority
or obligation.
Yes. Very good point, actually. Yes, very good point. I think people should be aware that what we're talking about are crimes against humanity. Large scale, you know, global, but in every country, these are crimes against humanity. And what is, you know, also very good to know is that there are certain jurisdictions, for example, Belgium and all these old maritime countries have something that is called universal jurisdiction, I think. So this means that crimes against humanity can be, these cases can be heard in Belgium, wherever they are in the world. So that's also, you know, a useful nugget for victims to know. But it's amazing. So what I really encourage people to, or encourage victims to do is just keep going back. And of course, I understand that people are scared to be sectioned. So I think if you can, don't go alone. And also, if you can, take a little audio recorder. And sometimes it is illegal to record conversations without telling people. But then again, we are talking, you know, deep capture, crimes against humanity, and huge corruption in law enforcement. So I think actually recording truthfully a conversation with a public official, that's like the least, you know, the least illegality in the entire scene. You know, I think people should stop worrying about that. Essentially, and I think in certain jurisdictions you can certainly record things for your own records, you know, to jog your memory to be sure that it's not going to be used against you in court. I think that's okay. So I would advise against publishing that online. but certainly recording it is a very good idea.
Anybody else want to chime in on what they've been doing lately or what's been happening with them, or comment on Catherine's experience yesterday?
Well, I think it's a fabulous thing that she did to, you know, get that recording and have spoken to somebody so high up. There's not any kind of deniability that they can come out with at this point, you know. And for him to later say, well, I didn't know what was going on. Well, what kind of boob is in the managerial position if you didn't know what your underlings were doing, you know? I'm sorry, but my GS5 and GS7 underlings were warring against citizens of the country, and I had no idea what was going on. Well, what is wrong with you? You know? So I think that's excellent that Catherine got that on tape.
And what was absolutely fantastic, and this is something that I couldn't have foreseen going there, is that because I intimidated him, he actually started gloating how high up in the agency he is, and he wanted to say, look, I know everything, we know everything that's going on in our agency, and we don't do that. You know, I'm really high up. And I was like, brilliant, you are really high up. You know everything. You just, you know, confirmed it. Thank you.
Yes. Yeah, he just hanged himself. So that was good. Good, mm-hmm. Gosh.
Yeah, I think it's absolutely amazing that you did that, Catherine. I mean, hats off to you. That was totally brilliant. Mm-hmm. And I guess, as you said, it was, you know, providence that you got to meet this super higher up, right? Incriminating himself on audio, although he doesn't know it. Well, he probably does now. But...
I mean, the other thing that has to be said is that it is only thanks to my gang stalkers that I even got into the building and got to talk to him like that. If the gang stalker hadn't sat in the car park in such an obvious fashion, they were trying to say, we're watching everything you do. And that's why they were so prominent outside the military HQ when I went in, not knowing that this would be just the perfect occasion to point to him and say, look, clearly there's an agent sitting on that stone over there. Let's go inside. He couldn't say no because it was so obvious, you know. Yeah, and this is how sometimes you can take essentially what I call judo against them and use the fact that they are so in your face and they are so obvious, you know, because that's how they are trying to disconcert victims. And that's essentially the psychological terrorism aspect, that they are so in your face. But at some point, if you record them, it's so in your face, you can use it in court.
Yes, and you know, I woke up this morning to like the sound of helicopters, literally like for 30 minutes. And I wondered, what did I do yesterday that brought this on? I mean, of course, I was thinking this has to do with me, right? And, you know, delusions of grandeur, et cetera. Maybe it did. But as I got out to my car to take my daughter to school this morning, a helicopter flew directly overhead. I mean, it was making such a point. I mean, literally over my head, you know, crossing from the backyard to across the street. And I was thinking, the last thing I did last night was look up your video where you reported this conversation. And, you know, I read your emails and I wrote back to you. And the thought struck me that perhaps that had something to do with it, you know?
It's just like when you sent the memorandum to Donald Trump. I didn't know what I had done. I was cooked in my flat. I had to flee my home. And it was only when I jumped into my car and the radio just, you know, burst out full volume saying memorandum to Donald Trump. I was like, oh. But, you know, it's brilliant because I think you are so well known, Ramola, right? So I think in your community, people know you. Read your blogs, and then when they see that the helicopter's above you, they're like, okay, Ramola is fighting for us. She's done it again.
Oh my God. You know, I wonder what they're doing in terms of what kind of message they're attempting to send. Because around this neighborhood, everyone must think, my goodness, I'm really high-profile criminal to have these helicopters buzz me all the time.
I don't think anybody in the community will think, oh yes, you know, high profile criminal who's a mom taking her daughter to school. You know, it's like, yeah, those are the people we need those helicopters for. You know, I think so many people have read your memorandum to Donald Trump. They're like, okay, there's the person fighting the CIA, you know.
Oh my gosh, yeah. Yeah, actually, I wanted to make a point about what you said. You said two things that were really, really interesting. One, you said that most victims currently are in a twilight zone. And I think that's exactly right. That's the perfect metaphor, because it's the twilight zone that's been created for us. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the twilight zone of going to the police station and immediately being sectioned. You go in to complain that you are being assaulted with microwave radiation that's coming at you from the direction of your neighbor's houses, and you get sectioned, you get Baker acted, you get thrown into a psych ward, you get psychiatrists brought out to look at you and examine you under a microscope, you know? That is absolute nonsense. So that is a complete scenario. It's a setup. It's a total setup. And this is how they're trying to keep the whole story of targeting and the whole story of EMF assault on civilians completely under wraps. Not to mention implants. I mean, I was sharpshot in a park and on a beach. And Katherine's also had that experience of being sharpshot. You know, a sharpshooter literally shot something into my left ear, which I have now recognized as a cochlear implant, because it flares up constantly when it's probed, you know, with radar. So I can feel it. And that's the other thing. I'm very body sensitive, but I would imagine anybody with an implant would feel it, you know? So I definitely feel these radio waves hitting. And this happened just on a walk in the morning, on a snowy morning, actually, 3 winters ago, to a local park with my dog, and a woman comes in with her dog, you know, exchanges a brief hello, walks across the park, and from across the park, suddenly I just sort of look up because I hear a whizzing sound at my left ear, and I look up, and she's standing diagonally across from me with her jacket open, with something in her jacket that she's kind of holding. I immediately felt I was being attacked. I grabbed my dog and ran out of the park because I didn't know what else to, frankly, what else could I do? You know?
You didn't have a flashlight either.
No, and unfortunately.
That's a private joke, guys.
And no taekwondo either. So I ran. I ran home, and unfortunately, there was a little laceration right there. And before you know it, I was being tracked like you would not believe. And there were planes that time all the time over my house and yard, continuously. You know, and I could feel. And some people, those people who don't know that this is what DIs are being subjected to, don't know that you can be tracked through these chips from great distances. You know, you can be tracked from a plane that's several hundreds of meters away. You can be tracked from, you know, cars that are not on your block, but 2 blocks away. You can be tracked, in fact, from space with some of these implants, according to various experts who write about these things. So in any case, so I, you know, distinctly felt I was being tracked. So we are being sharpshot in daylight, in, you know, in broad daylight. Who does that? And that's the other point that you made, Katherine, that I wanted to come to. The intelligence agencies are doing this. Military factions are doing this. Private companies with defense contracts are doing this. They're doing this and they think they can get away with it by keeping it completely under wraps. You know?
Oh, it's national security concerns.
Exactly.
We can't tell you.
We can't tell you that you are the subject of a criminal investigation. You are now listed with the FBI, with the FISA court, with whoever. You know, we're not going to tell you if you are or if you are not. It's all national security. And never mind that you're just, you know, a teacher of art workshops for children, or that you're a registered nurse who's retired. never mind these innocuous things. You are now under criminal investigation. We are going to sharpshoot you and stick implants in you. We're going to track you till your death. We're going to put you on life monitoring. We're going to come into your home and stick bugs all around your residence and watch you in every room of your house, night and day. For what purpose? Why does the NSA need to do this? You know, why does the CIA need to do this? Why do they need to monitor me morning and night in the bathroom? You know? And we're going to hit you. We're going to hit you 24/7 with electromagnetic radiation, with microwave radiation. We also can hit you with lasers, masers, anything we like. And no one will know. And if you go to the police station and say you're being hit with radiation, we're going to deny it because that's our plan. So, you know, I think it's very important to continually underline and continually document and continually research and uncover really how the intelligence agencies have been covering this up. And that's really one of my real interests as a writer. And this is why I dig out those articles and information from archives, from various, you know, websites, from various books, to show that, for one, RFID implants were invented in 1969, and they've been in use in the intelligence agencies ever since. They're now under wraps. They're now being covered up, but everybody knows they exist, and there's a whole industry surrounding them. And you know, then again, there's Millicent should really be here because we have the other aspect of this, which is the whole medical industry, the whole medical world, which is using implants, right? And which is using neurostimulators for all sorts of reasons now. And so, sorry, that's my dog. I think he's barking at birds in the backyard. So we have that as well. And so there is, and currently, and again, this is something that we are uncovering today by looking at people's cases. There's a lot of research that's going on, medical research that's going on, interdisciplinary research, I should say, with defense grants being conducted by universities. And universities are engaging in these covered projects. So you have students, grad students from universities engaging in these. You have academicians, you have faculty, tenured faculty engaging in these. You have physicians and hospitals associated with universities engaging in these. And what I'm really saying is they are giving covered agencies non-consensual covert access to the bodies of patients in their care. And so this is why you have non-consensual surgeries, you have non-consensual covert implantation, and that opens the door to targeting for life, to becoming a research subject for life without your consent.
Yeah. And I've termed it becoming an untouchable, you know, it's becoming basically they're creating a class of untouchables, people who don't have constitutional rights, much less human or civil rights. And then you go to any and all authorities and they treat you like you don't exist or like a crazy person. Mm-hmm. Well, I will give a quick example in that in Tallahassee, Florida, I tried to get the sheriff's department there to help me because I had tracked down who had what type of device aimed at us through patterns of behavior and measurements of devices that measured electromagnetic radiation, microwave, et cetera. And I had filmed these meters in specific locations and said, all right, today's Tuesday, May 24th, 2016, I'm in the backyard. And then I would film it because I knew they can't see it, they can't hear it. So I would show it to the sheriff's deputies and they would say, we don't know what that means. And so you have proof for them, they won't accept it as proof. You take this to them and they won't even look at the proof. And the people at the basic level are so, I guess, propagandized to just blow off anything that you have to say, you know, that they don't allow themselves any type of reasoning whatsoever. And they do, they get insulting and multiple people gang stalking you, being paid to gang stalk you, is not against the law. Only if one person gang stalk, only if one person stalks you, is that a crime. What? Well, one, she didn't understand about RICO, because that is basically a plot, you know, and it's a plot to deprive you of your constitutional rights. But then the higher ups must be bribed. They have to be bribed, you know, just to ignore it. Because I took paperwork to the Tallahassee police, the sheriff's department, and they refused to take it. They refused to look at it. They refused to take it. So we are definitely being secretly put into a cast of untouchables, and people are told you can do anything you want to them. It's okay. Now, how we've come to become such a sociopathic society that the person next door would gladly sacrifice your human, civil, and constitutional rights for what I've termed beer and whore money, I don't know. You know, that's pathetic. And that is not a civilization at all, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. And the thing is that the neighbors are also being terrorized, you know, because you have people like the CIA showing up with badges, or people like the FBI showing up with badges and saying, we're investigating this person, we need your cooperation. So I think that's part, definitely part of what's going on. But I also wonder if there are other aspects also going on, because one of the things that I see, or that perhaps I'm being kind of guided to see, is when I'm driving on the roadways, I'm constantly being, you know, the people crossing my path have these skull and bones symbols on their trucks. And then you have the Who But The Masons big truck that parks here all the time. I mean, it's almost like it's been parked there right on my drive. This happens quite often, and I've actually got this on video a couple times. And then I have, there's something else. Oh, the guys who come and park on the street, and of course I know they're hitting me because, you know, again, this is directional and I've measured it with the meter. And then I go out and look out the window and I see this dark blue truck with FBA, a sticker called with FBA on it, whatever that is. I don't know. And you know, the big letters.
Ramola, I think I know what it is. Maybe it's a reference to what, you know, if the FBI is the Federal Bureau of Investigation, this must be the Federal Bureau of Assholes.
We needed you, Katherine, to say that.
Oh, boy.
Perfect. That must be exactly what it is. And, you know, it's a sort of a thin disguise, perhaps. And also a big sticker with Cook on it. Now, you know the Cook brothers, right? The Cooks, or however you pronounce your name. I'm, you know, I'm being kind.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So you, yeah. Maybe you say cock, okay. So,
whatever.
Now these guys, we know those two brothers, but also in Quincy, the mayor's name is Cook. And I really don't know the antecedents there, if he's related to those guys, to the brothers. But his name is Thomas P. Cook. So what are they trying to tell me? The mayor is after me now? For what? So this is what
And they always want to tell you, we're watching you. It's like, right. Really? What are you watching me walk the dog? You're watching me wash the car. You're watching me take my elderly mother to the doctor. Ooh.
Yes. Know? Scary. And I walk into the grocery store and there's a guy, you know, sort of sitting at a table and pointing his cell phone at me and getting all excited as soon as he sees me and starts, you know, pointing at me. It's sort of, I'm surveilling you. Look, you're being surveilled and everybody knows it. So, sure, go ahead. Surveil me. What are you surveilling me? I'm coming in to buy some bananas or something. Go ahead. So you're right. It's pointless. It's stupid. It's petty. And they've gotten whole communities wrapped up in this idiocy, this absolute idiocy.
Well, no, I think not exactly Einsteins when you stop and try to talk to them. They're real... You know, they really aren't.
No, and they start shaking in their shoes.
Work job for the stupidest people.
Yeah, I think, you know, I think what's really important in all this, because this is what's so shocking, all across the world, we've seen the same thing. And I think at some point we should almost make a public collection of all the standard tricks, because everything you mentioned, Ramola, being sharp shot, well, I was sharp shot into my arm here at the end of the street here in Canton Zurich. I was sharp shot in the neck in the Radcliffe Science Library in Oxford. At the time, I didn't know if I was sharp shot into the neck or if that was maybe a laser pulse that was just painful on the skin. No idea. But, you know, the two people who were inside, and this is a controlled environment, so only people with a Bodleian, it's called the Bodleian Access Card of the University of Oxford, can get down into the Radcliffe Science Library, where I was, you know, shot in the neck. And the same two young people who were prime, you know, gang stalking ages hired by MI5 these days, they stalked me all the way back to the train station hours later and then back on the train to London, you know, sitting next to me on the train, miraculously, you know. So I have experienced that. And also the messaging with the cars. So after I had, the assassination attempt that I survived, which was essentially me going to the military police saying, look, I'm being attacked, please help me. They don't help you. And then they almost assassinate you, you know, a couple of days later, where I just passed a military police vehicle. I'm not sure if it was the military police shooting me. I think it came from a car behind me, but certainly they made this game of, look, there's a military police van, you just pass it and you almost die on the road because we shoot you in the back of the head, you know, as you're driving your car. And at every serpentine, you know, coming down from Davos, there's a hill in the forest, a mountain. As you're coming down, there are these serpentines, and I was shot into the head every single time, meters before the turn. So trying to disorient me and trying to make me break the barrier into the abyss. And then when you survive that, and it wasn't just one shot, it was actually every single turn they were trying their chance. And then when you survive that, I'm on the motorway, and I thought, right, I'm going to calm down and I'm going to drive slowly. And we've got a speed limit of 120 kilometers per hour. So I was doing 100. Now, only lorries and other slow vehicles do that. And I'm, kind of driving along, and the car is really close behind me, not overtaking and tailgating me for ages. And then eventually it overtook me, like demonstratively, and then was in front of me equally slowly. And on the back, they had written broken fate.
Oh.
I'm like, come on.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. They have all these weird little license plates. I mean, there was a car in front of me yesterday which said Stooges. And then it had a whole bunch of stickers. And I've read elsewhere that people who carry these strange stickers, and believe it or not, even the peace stickers and the coexist stickers are supposedly people connected, you know, with Satanist connections. It's part of the whatever, the witches or whoever they are.
Yeah. So, and, you know, when we're surrounded by these people, I think what we have to do is, I think what has happened, and I believe this has been, you know, because it's global and it's timed, you know, it's not just something happening in the US, a freak event in a community. This is a global program, and it has been carefully choreographed, and the money has been carefully guided. The brainwash and the propaganda has been carefully guided. And as Eric Karlstrom found out, they're using a set protocol developed by the CIA, you know, the death squad protocol. They've got their matrices and their control centers and so on all around the world. And when it's this formal, it actually makes it very easy for us because, you know, we don't have to just go after freak events here and there. This is a program. And I think we should just essentially break the psyop by saying, calling it out for what it is. This is a Nazi program. So instead of tattooing a serial number into our arm, they sharpshoot us an RFID chip that has the serial number, that has a, you know, a set frequency.
Mm-hmm.
Thing of shooting things into our brain, those are Nazi experiments.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I think what we have to do is really focus on essentially the key things that once you recognize that, it all just, you know, becomes clear. And it also very much reminds me of this, you know, the entire industry with contractors being allowed to do whatever they like and, you know, taking over not just defense functions, but law enforcement and so on. It reminds me of that speech in 2009 by Christopher Story. And essentially Christopher Story said, you know, he in this interview, I think it was about EU corruption. It was on the BBC. And he said
you know, we do have now this tendency of, you know, of essentially our defense and law enforcement functions being privatized. And if, and his sentence was, if we think about it for longer than 3 seconds, we'll realize how dangerous that is. It is dangerous because essentially you are giving, there's a reason why law enforcement and all these things are meant to be done by the state. And I know that there's lots of corruption in the state as well, but the point is that you've got more control when the state does it than when private corporations do it, where you've got no control whatsoever. There is no democratic control. There are no institutions. You don't have a say. So when you have military or law enforcement privatization, what you have is essentially a return towards mercenary armies. And they were deadly. They were already deadly in the medieval ages, precisely because no one could control them. Mm-hmm. You know, it was a huge issue. I think I remember reading a book about the Hundred Years' War. And they, in the Hundred Years' War, which, as the name already, you know, tells you, was a very long war, you know, going on and on and on. So they had these huge marauding armies. And at some point, they had a peace treaty between England and France. And then these marauding hordes, because they were essentially paid to kill and murder and pillage, they just continued doing their day job. So you had these mercenary armies rampaging through Europe, pillaging and murdering, even though they weren't actually paid soldiers anymore. They just did it privately, you know? I mean, that was the first example of a public-private partnership, if you like, you know? But the point was no one could control them. So not even kings and you know, of French and English kings. So eventually they had to find a solution. I can't remember the details because I'm not a historian, but I think eventually they got the Pope to get these people to start essentially a war with Spain to just get them the hell out of Europe, you know, by just channeling them away. And that's what we have to realize. And that's what we're seeing with these gang stalkers. These are essentially professional harassers. You know, I think the best term, and I'm sorry for using this word, but it just made me laugh. There was a YouTube video by a victim, and he came up with the best term. He actually says these are professional fuck withers because they just fuck with you for a living. You know, I just know a better way to say that. That's what they're doing. There's nothing respectful about what they're doing. But they cannot be controlled because they're all private. They're mercenary marauding hordes. And if you put it, zoom out and look at the historical context, I think it was, oh God, I forget. There was a treaty, I think in the 17th century or something, where I think it was exactly to get rid of these mercenary armies that they said, you know, only the state or the king has got the right to have standing armies and things like that. Because they realized if you just break it up, and anybody can have their own personal army, then anybody will have their personal war. You can't have that. And now we have exactly that, you know, all of us, some of us know who put us on these lists. We know that we are essentially, what we are fighting is a personal vendetta here. We are, you know, at war because some higher people have their personal vendettas against certain victims, you know. And I think this is a wake-up call, because if this continues, what will happen is that people will have their career paths, their income streams, they will rely on it. They pick up skills and they build up networks. And even when they get fined once, they will go back to the same networks, just like the mercenaries of the 14th century, you know. They'll have their buddies in gang stalking and buddies doing break-ins. And what we have is that the government trained professional burglars. The government trained professional assassins. And when they spend 5 years, you know, 5 years doing that sort of job, they want to continue doing that. Because we all know that retraining for a new job is difficult, you know, so they want to use their own network. So the problem is even bigger than we realize. So that's why I'm saying we have to do something about it now. I also, you know, we had things on public calls where people said, oh, we will shut it down by 2020 and 2025. No, you don't understand. If we shut it down then, we'll be screwed forever.
You can't shut it down. That's ubiquitous.
Yeah.
We'll probably be dead by then.
Yeah.
We work right now.
Exactly. And I say, no, this is a national emergency. And we have to use the right terms. This is a national emergency. This is a war of a corrupt entity on us, on civilians of highest integrity. This is hugely damaging. And these are Nazi experiments, mm-hmm. Nazi death camp experiments. These are death squads. We are not being irradiated to make us prettier or healthier. We're being irradiated to age prematurely, to develop cancer, to have organ damage. And then they are just accumulating data on how quickly you get organ damage. What's that good for? That's not science. We don't need any more data on how we get to degrade ourselves. We need data on how we can cure ourselves. That's what science is. And I think there is a distinction between real science, and I do talk about as a scientist now, within real science that is for the betterment of humanity, and essentially Nazi science, degenerate criminal science. This is criminal. It's not science. So I have gone public about something that I found was shocking, that was meant to be a DARPA psychological experiment run on me. I'm going to call it out for what it is. This is a crime against humanity. And I want every victim to take the courage to actually use this vocabulary, because as soon as you say Nazi crimes, which is what these are, people wake up. We all had history at school, you know, we all understand what it is. When we go on about electronic harassment, that's nonsense. It's not harassment. It's
absolutely wrong. That is the wrongest terminology on the face of the planet. And you know, it's planted terminology. It's terminology that's been planted in our midst by the first and the earliest government infiltrators who have sought to silence those who are being falsely targeted and those who are speaking out. By giving us terminology, call it organized stalking, call it electronic harassment. In fact, call it OS/EH. This is so wrong. It's not harassment. I'm not being harassed. The word shooting is accurate, Katherine, as you say, because, for instance, when that memo to Trump was published on my website, for a whole week, I was shot into my head from all directions. I had to lie down on the couch where I was sitting and throw shielding all over me. And I was still hit with a migraine. I had a terrible infection. I mean, it was deathly. And I told you guys, I remember reporting all this. It was horrifying for like a week and a half. And then after that, they kind of varied. They got very creative with their attacks after that. They started to hit my face and, oh, terrible stuff. So this stuff is not harassment. I'm not being harassed. I'm being attacked to the death, you know?
It's electronic poisoning. It's electronic poisoning. At a certain point in time, your cells cannot regenerate, and mm-hmm. something goes wrong, and you die. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like arsenic poisoning. Yeah, you can take in a little bit at a time for a while, but after a while, you hit capacity, and you're dead, which is mm-hmm. exactly the same with electronic poisoning.
Exactly.
And that's what we're getting.
And remember, it's being coupled with chemtrails. So literally, and around in those 2 weeks, I remember the skies around my house, around this neighborhood, were simply flooded with streamers of horrific stuff being poured out of those planes. And so when you go out, and of course, you're going to breathe in the air, you know, what else can you do? You're breathing in whatever they've got in there, whatever viruses, bacteria are being rained down on you. And then you're being irradiated at the same time. And you know, there's this issue of cyclotron resonance where, and by the way, talking about good science, bad science, this is what DARPA and defense and the defense industry is doing. They have contracts out, and you can look this up, where they are putting aerosols, they're putting bacteria into the air, and they are trying to find out how radiation is going to affect that. They're trying to find out the bio effects of radiation on select targets in the population. I mean, the stuff is actually out there. This information is out there.
You know what? We should take that, because I want to call them out right now. If they're doing that, they are Nazi organization. That's it.
And in fact, I commend you highly, Katherine, because you brought that terminology forward. These are Nazi death camp experiments. You know, and this is Nazi experimentation. So enough talking about the name targeted individual, which has become such a label and such a joke, you know?
And not just that, targeted individual puts the focus on us. There's nothing wrong with us. The focus should be on them.
Exactly. You know? Exactly. And the targeting is so wrongful as well. So some people prefer to use the term wrongfully targeted, which is accurate. We are being wrongfully targeted. But the word target itself is a military term.
Yeah.
You know, it's a term that comes from attack terminology. There's the target. We're going to go after the target, you know, with our sensors and with our radar, with our location protocols, whatever, tracking, clandestine tracking, et cetera, et cetera. So yes, I think we all have a problem with that term, targeted individual, which has sort of been bequeathed. And for us to say, oh, we are targeted individuals, that is so wrong. No, we are being attacked, and we, for whatever reason, because we're outspoken, because we make public comment on websites, because we call corruption out when it crosses our path, because we crossed the path of some criminal and we spoke out, which appears to be the case, you know, for so many. And this is, as you also said, it's a takedown operation. It's a takedown operation of the best and the brightest, the most outstanding, the most outspoken, in order also to set an example for the rest of our communities, to say, look at what's going on here. In fact, Millicent said this is called whistleblower training in the military and in the Air Force circle.
You know, actually, you sparked so many points in my head, because already wrongful targeting implies that targeting would be appropriate in any way. It is not. We still live in a democracy where an actual legal process is required. I can't just go out and punish people, you know, be judge and executioner on one person. No, none of us had a court hearing. None of us were charged with anything. So, you know, essentially, that's already the fact targeting means that someone is doing something highly illegal, because targeting is illegal on so many levels. It also, I think Karen is also very right, and we should keep it in mind, what they're essentially creating is a class of outcasts, outlaws. Now, outlaws were essentially gotten rid of in the medieval ages. So this is like not even medieval anymore. This is pre-medieval what they're doing.
It is, and communities are being trained to see us as outcasts.
Yeah.
Communities are being trained to recreate the leper colonies of the days of yore, you know, to recreate the untouchables in the Indian castes of yore.
Yeah, and not just that, recreate the Jews in the Second World War.
And to recreate the Jews and everybody else, I mean, who was, you know, the Gypsies, the Romanians, the Poles, who are Polish people, who were, you know, ostracized and treated horribly by the Nazis.
Well, it turns civilization into a predator-prey dichotomy.
Yes.
And we are not only seen as outcasts or scapegoats, mm-hmm. but we're seen as cash cows.
Yeah.
Correct. Exactly. I mean, and this actually pulls in to what we are learning today from Vault 7 and from other things that are coming out currently, right, with the Petergate investigations and so forth. There's organ harvesting going on.
Yeah.
There's child trafficking going on. There's child abuse on such a horrendous scale that's going on, you know, within these satanic circles. There are people drinking the blood of children, for God's sake.
Yeah.
I mean, this kind of stuff would have been thought of as absolutely unheard of even a few years ago. Ted, you know, I remember 5 years ago seeing something like this on the internet and thinking, my God, these are really crazy stories. Yeah. But now, today, we know these are not really crazy stories. This is actually the truth that's coming out, the sordid truth that's coming out.
Yeah.
So, no, you know,
those types of stories, you used to, every so often you saw something like that came from a distant island where they had been left alone and not known any type of civilization, you know, outside civilization had come in, until maybe missionaries or somebody came in and saw they were doing things that horrific, you know. But now it's in your backyard, it's your next door neighbor, it's the councilman, right. You know, it's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. Yeah. We are living in a shill. I mean, the whole society is rotten to the core, and we haven't noticed that the skin hasn't really started to rot on the outside, so we're not aware that the apple is rotten inside, and it's about to collapse. I mean, with what the gang stalkers are doing as far as the electronic poisoning, the electronic attacks, you know, we've spoken before, you know, they usually basically target somebody's house from 3-4 directions so that once the field comes into play in the house, then you've got an overlay of 3 or 4 of those fields. And of course, it's magnified so that you feel it horrendously. But the guy walking through one field across this, you know, one of these fields being projected across the street, he won't really notice it, you know, because one, he's only in it for a minute and a half to walk through it. And he's not getting all 4 of these devices multiplied on him. But what they don't understand is that when these, you know, neighbors think, well, thank God it's not me, and then I'm just going to mind my own business and then I'll be safe. No, you're getting radiation too. Yeah. This is not directional. I mean, you can focus a large amount of it toward that person, but it disperses. Yeah. It is not limited to that person. So the people next door to them are likely to come down with cancer just as much as the person you're targeting. And the idiots using these devices are probably going to get sick as well. But another thing to consider, though, is that the people who have been bribed to take these devices into their homes and aim that at you are getting paid. Yes. And they're getting paid a certain amount, and the government is going to want that back. So as soon as the person that they want killed is gone, then that family is going to be in a car accident where a semi hits them, or some other type of accident, and then they're going to have their insurance policies that the government took out on them, unbeknownst to them, cashed in, and the government's going to get every cent that it paid to them to help kill you back.
That's very good.
So these people are signing their own death warrants, as well as poisoning every single person in that neighborhood.
Yes, that's an excellent point. So basically you're saying the thugs who are running these scenarios, you know, under cover of legitimate government, are actually going to finish off the witnesses.
Yeah.
Right? And the device wielders. Yeah, they're proxies, in other words. Yeah.
Right. And get rid of the witnesses. Mm-hmm. And get their money back.
I think that's a very, very good point, because certainly on the physics, one of the things that I can confirm is that, yes, what they're going to do, because as soon as if you just think about it, as soon as a wave, like a shot from a microwave gun, hits the surface, there's a certain fraction that gets reflected back. You know, it's impossible to pass a beam through a boundary without having some sort of back reflections, you know. You have to have essentially no boundary to have zero back reflection. So as soon as you shoot at the wall, it's going to reflect back one fraction. If you shoot at the wall that's slanted, the back reflection is going to go off and hit another neighbor. You know, but you have essentially direct back reflections. And, you know, if there are 3 points, then another guy who's irradiating you might end up hitting another perp, you know? So, and this sort of, that's exactly what Karen meant, and it's true. And it actually, it can be highly focused as well, you know? And
this actually connects with very recently, I think maybe 10 years ago or something, there was a group of policemen who got together and presented before Congress about how the backlash from these radar guns that they are using are creating cancer.
Yeah, exactly.
And they're... The gun is aimed at you, it's not aimed at them, but yet they're getting cancer.
Yeah.
It's and not as directional as they're being led to believe.
Exactly. And it's because as soon as you hit something, even a person, it reflects directly back at you. But also I suspect that these guns have a lot of leakage as well. Mm-hmm. You know. So it's not perfectly, so you have always these two things, leakage and back reflections. And yeah, it's true. They are being hit. They're being hit. And I think once we have this sort of situation in the world, I mean, what is pretty clear is I actually do have come to the, you know, to the opinion that this is part of what's it called, Agenda 21, of just wiping people out and so on. And using the standard thing of setting each other up to attack each other and wiping each other out. That's exactly what it is. You know, as you all said, you know, and the government or the cartel behind the government, the deep state, will get every penny back from all of us. I think this is, there's a huge financial element, absolutely. And the question is, so, you know, now that we, we said all this, and we know that we have to do something now, because if we don't, there's also these multiplication effects. You know, people set themselves up with a certain career stream, networks build, these networks are impossible to erase afterwards. Even if you ban them, they're going to regroup and so on. So there's a huge problem unfolding here. The question is, when we're faced with this catastrophe, which is also what I call the Titanic having hit the iceberg, we're already sinking. We can't repair the Titanic. The question is, what are we going to do? What is the mechanism through which we can pull this up, you know, pull up the diving plane, to use another metaphor? And I think what we have to do is, whatever we do, we have to do it fast. Whatever we do, we have to use amplification effects, which is why I absolutely love this, you know, conference call, because we're going to put it out, and it's not just going to be us, you know, people here as four people talking, or five people. It will be hopefully be seen by thousands. And we should also, whatever we do, we should give people tools to duplicate our work, add to it, and bring in their own ideas. But we have a quick evolution of ideas. And also, whatever we do, and we already are doing this, you know, we should do it in a decentralized fashion. Because after all, we have founded this joint investigation team, but we also have, every single one of us has kept our own personal freedom, you know, to continue. We're not telling each other what to do. The only thing we're pooling is actually the benefit and the outcome and the end result. And I would really encourage everybody to imitate us, get together in small groups. Whatever you do, make it such that you publish it so that other people can benefit, you know, let them copy. Also, I want to say a lot about copyright, because it's the old classical model of copyright where it's like, oh, it's mine, you know, only I can use this idea and you have to pay me royalties. That's actually a very kind of, it's like it has got negative benefit. There's another way where the benefits explode for all parties involved, which is to say, okay, this is what I've done. You can duplicate it and you can add to it. But if you do, I will copy you back, you know, because then you suddenly have this kind of stepping function. You know, I come up with a good idea. If you copy it, you've duplicated the effect. So my idea has got twice as much. But then when you see a good idea, you're likely to add to it. And if I can copy back, you pulled me up. So we're both here. You know, copyright is just like, I'm here and everybody's below. When you allow people to copy and add to it, and then you yourself in turn copy the idea back, you know, you have this sort of stepping function and quick learning effect.
And not only that, remember what we are talking about. We're talking about literally human rights activism and human rights advocacy. So really, copyright shouldn't exist, in my view, you know, because we're talking about saving each other. Saving ourselves and saving each other from the concentration camp, you know, from the Nazis, from the gas ovens. So, are we going to sit around, you know, talking about copyright and intellectual property, or are we going to help each other? You know, so that's really my point of view. I just think, sorry, I won't take money for anything I do. I'll throw myself into this to the max of my ability, use my voice and my writing abilities to the extent that I can, and give it freely to anybody who thinks it can be useful. And actually, Katherine, your idea of decentralizing is absolutely brilliant. To say, let's work together in small groups. So here we are, you know, we're talking openly, we're making a plan, we're going to go ahead with a few strategies that we can think of, and throwing it out to everybody, go ahead, use our plans if you want to, but please form your own little groups and take some action, you know? So I personally think that's so much better than saying, let's all get together and form an organization with a president and a treasurer and a vice president, and you be this department and you be that department, and I'll tell you what to do. You know, that we've seen that in action. We're seeing that in action every single day. We are being attacked with that particular protocol in action currently. You know, we don't need that in our lives. We don't need incorporation. We don't, you know, we don't need corporations. We don't need one massive organization, I don't think.
Okay. You know, I so totally agree. And, you know, there is this discussion again around the world about, oh, we need one big victim organization. And I say, and this ties in with exactly what Paul has been lecturing on. It's like, no, when you have an organization, you have this pyramid hierarchy, it's a psychopath magnet. And
It will be captured. It will be infiltrated. And I think this is exactly why they're suggesting it, because they know they can infiltrate it. And I'm just saying, no, just have little groups, free association. If you think these people take you further, go and work with them. As soon as you've got your doubts, bugger off. Find your own group or do something else, or then rejoin them later if you like them again, and just keep it open. Because then you're just focused on progress and not focused on individuals, personalities, or organizational structures.
And also think about how infiltrated we are, in our groups. And think about how easy it would be for a group of infiltrators to pass themselves off as legitimately wrongfully targeted people and then organize the legitimately wrongfully targeted people and so set up their own organization. So how easy is that to do? So in other words, we would then be directed by infiltrators.
Exactly.
People from the agencies who are striving to keep us down, striving to shut us up, striving to keep our voices from reaching the larger world. And that really is, I think, well, I could go on for hours about that, but I really, really think one of the main things we need to do is inform the global public of the reality of what is going on. Because we are living in a vacuum of mainstream media, which has totally abandoned us. We're living in a vacuum also of most alternative media, which won't touch this and hasn't touched this as yet. We're living in a vacuum of human rights organizations, big ones, the most well-known ones who have totally abandoned those who have gone to them for help. And I'm talking about the ACLU, I'm talking about Amnesty International, I'm talking about the International Red Cross, even the United Nations, although there's been some progress made there, I think. And there's definitely, I think there's definitely hope always in going back to these organizations and going back and presenting our information. But I think it's also pointful to note that we have been living in the Twilight Zone for many years. People have been abandoned, So now we have to make our own strategies, and we have to move forward in the ways that we can see. But I think one of the main things we need to do is, inform the public, let people know what's going on.
And not just inform them, also maybe suggest ideas for tools, This is it. Like whatever we do, we just put it out there, and then people can use the tools, copy them, add to them, or suggest something better, Put something else out there, because then we really benefit from everybody's input. I think it's, it is true that Google was essentially founded by the CIA. It is true that Google owns YouTube. Nevertheless, it's still functional. Mm-hmm. It's still functional. And everybody in a decentralized fashion can use Google. Everybody can put out their voice on YouTube. It's for free. It is actually a huge public service. And nothing stops us from being our own media, being our own reporters. And I think what we, because I'm not essentially a media person at all. I've never been on media, yet I was, through my situation, I was forced to go online out of utter desperation. And I'm just learning the tools of the trade as I go along. But I have to say, I find it an incredibly encouraging experience. It was essentially through, alternative media and YouTube and all these, even Skype, that we managed to pull this together and that I managed to find you, and this is hugely powerful. I think what we're seeing is essentially the power of networks and network mathematics. It's this perfect freedom. And we should encourage people to use that freedom. Even if you think that Google is a weapon developed by DARPA, okay, for goodness sake, but you have it, use it. Use it against them. If they've given you this weapon, if you consider Twitter, YouTube, and Google to be a weapon, use it. Mm-hmm. But it's up to you how you use it.
Oh, and Facebook.
Yeah, Facebook, exactly. So, I was thrown off Facebook after, I think, 1 or 2 days on it. And they wanted me to certify my existence through my passport. And it was so much administrative hassle. I'd never went back to Facebook, I was like, oh, God. But I should go back. I should just force the system. We shouldn't just be kind of cowed by these fort walls that they erect everywhere. We should bat the walls down, And I'm a great proponent of just saying, use Facebook to complain about Facebook. I mean, what better thing to do? I mean, Facebook has this new, what do they call it, Building 7 or whatever, the black building. They have got some name for their brain or, you know, mind-machine interface research team. That sounds very creepy.
Yeah.
But maybe we should start complaining about that on Facebook.
Yeah. Well, you know, people do use Facebook to sort of pass around information that Facebook doesn't like anymore because Mark Zuckerberg doesn't like it. And of course, as you know, now they've teamed up with Google and they're going to put disputed tags on news stories that they don't like because they don't want people to read them. So that's actually very easy to combat. So we just send out a lot of information saying anything with a disputed tag from Facebook is must reading.
Yeah, exactly. That's how we
have stuff.
Yeah, that's exactly how I read my on YouTube. I notice that the really good links will end up on in the spam box. You know, mm-hmm. I put my comments or messages and then likely spam. And I thought maybe spam actually stands for special attention messages. So I should read those first. So I just log into YouTube and I go to my special attention, you know, messages folder. It's the spam, you know.
No, that's exactly what's happening, I think. We posted a video a couple of days ago. And of course, the spy agencies get on there first and they write the negative comments.
Yeah.
Down on the new video we made, the guy says, the trolls and the spams are really after this guy. He must have something to say. So we're really learning how to use their tools, I think.
Yeah.
I think at some point it becomes almost like anti-filtering. It becomes a badge of, you know, like
yes,
a rite of passage. Like amongst us, you know, having survived an assassination attempt is a rite of passage. You know, you've done something right that they tried to kill.
I know, exactly. And sort of becoming the focus of helicopter buzzings and, you know, plane flyovers constantly. Yeah, these are the ways in which we measure our value, apparently.
You know how the generals have these little like stars and whatever on their shoulders? You know, we should just have little helicopter symbols. Like how many helicopters track you when you leave the house, you know? So you should remember that you are two helicopter general on our team.
Just for today. You might beat me tomorrow.
Ramola, I keep thinking you're the most dangerous art teacher on the planet.
The most subversive, right?
Yeah, clearly art can kill, right?
Well, you see, what's really funny is I was teaching art, you know, even though I was working on a novel as well, but, you know, I was literally sort of gaining a very small income by teaching art and teaching science to little children. And here I have the entire city of Quincy coming down on me like a ton of bricks for doing that.
Oh, you know what, Ramola? It must have been martial arts.
Right.
I think that's it. Yeah. You know, maybe your artwork can be used as a weapon in the fight against corruption. They're like, okay, martial arts. You know, she's an expert in martial arts. Uh-oh.
Well, you know, I have to tell you, after that, I would write these snippy little emails to people saying, oh, I guess the CIA really wanted me to come after them. They couldn't let me alone to write my novel in peace or teach my little art classes. Oh, no, they really wanted to enlist me in this fight against them. And therefore, here I am.
Went out of their way.
They went out of
Special
their way.
Special invite finally. Only.
Exactly. Black tie event, invitation only.
Yeah. Well, I was watching YouTube and I forget the gentleman's name, but he's into, you know, end times prophecy. And he was talking to Leah Liaz, I believe, and said that somebody from NSA came to visit him, identified themselves as an agent from the National Security Agency. And he demanded to know where he was getting his information. And he said, the Bible. And you know, the parts of the Bible that deal with end times prophecy is where I'm getting my information. And he said that a guy acted like, well, he didn't believe that at all. He had to have been getting it from somewhere. And he was informed that the NSA did not like the fact that he was putting out this information and they wanted him to be quiet or else. And he said, a couple days later, somebody hit him in a car accident.
Oh my God.
Drove across several lanes of traffic and purposely hit him. So he thinks it's a warning that if you keep telling people what the Bible says about end times prophecy, we're going to kill you.
Oh my God. And it's the NSA out of all things. I mean, you know, maybe they're like, they're watching all the digital traffic and say, where does he get this information come from? It's not in the YouTubes he's watching. It's not in the emails. It's like, hello, a book. It's like, the NSA is like, what is this device? Does it have Bluetooth? Can we hack it?
Exactly.
You know, it's you know. Funny, but I think there's so much truth in this. The NSA and all those spy agencies, the dark, deep agencies are hiring contractors. And even Machiavelli, back in the 5th century, said, don't hire mercenaries because they'll take you over. What's happening is I think they're creating more confusion and more dystopian, scenarios for themselves and everybody else. Also, don't contractors have to have a contract? All comes down to this triangle organization and how they manage things. They have to be managed and sub-managed, and then it just seems like they're pretty vulnerable. I don't know. Maybe I'm crazy. I know we don't see it.
Yeah, and it's all about managing. Yes, as you say, it's all about managing. They want to manage. You know the giant octopus, the squid symbol they use. Wait, not the squid. I think it's the octopus, right? So they see themselves as this giant octopus with their little tentacles, their thousands of tentacles all over the world, literally wrapping around every single individual. And that's their dream. That's the NWO dream. To totally mind control every single individual, which is why they hate people like us, who are totally individualistic, totally independent, unafraid to speak our minds, and focusing on what we do, you know, with persistence. So this attempt to manage, we have to manage, and that it also goes back to the infiltration of groups.
Yes. It's you know what, everything, it's beautiful because everything all of us were individually seeing and working on kind of comes together now, you know, because what we're seeing is exactly what Paul was saying about these huge organizations and how slow they are and how stupid they are. They must be stupid because the person at the top doesn't have all the information that, you know, is collated from thousands and thousands of people. He doesn't have the time to read every report and know everything. So whatever he will decide will be totally out of place for large parts of the organization. And we are dealing with these huge, stupid organizations. And once you know, and actually another thing I noticed talking to this guy from Swiss intelligence yesterday is that they are so, it's a Swiss intelligence, their job, or not Swiss, intelligence in general, nothing particular about the Swiss. They are essentially trained con artists. They are trained to lie, to deceive, you know, to infiltrate, to sabotage, to subvert, and, you know, generally just, you know. And when you're doing that as a day job, this becomes your culture. But when, you know, faking things and dumbing things down and sabotaging things becomes your day job and your standard operating procedure, what actually happens is that stupidity becomes your standard operating procedure. And you know what it's like when you're doing something over and over during their day job and you just can't snap out of it. I mean, I know, for example, that primary school teachers, you can tell what class they are teaching, what year, because they will start talking to adults like that. You know, you literally have somebody who literally talks to you like as if you were a five-year-old, you know, and you have to kind of renormalize them that now they're back in the adult world. But, you know, that's what the human brain is like. And I'm just thinking these spy agents, they are surrounded in this fakery and stupidity and do it compulsively. You know, they literally cannot snap the hell out of it. And I was talking to this guy yesterday, and throughout this 1.5 hour meeting, I was thinking, can he not snap out of it? He knows I'm a physicist. He knows that I know what he knows. So can we just cut the crap? You know, we're just in a building, just you and I. Can we just cut it out? And he can't. He can't. He cannot, because that's his culture. He's like the primary school teacher is talking to me like, you know, the best thing was I literally got the giggles because he was going through all these different, he had a protocol and he said, you know, try this. And if this doesn't work, try that. And the the method was at first to say, oh, we know everything, so we don't do this, take it from me. And I was like, that's bollocks, you know, sorry, we've got the evidence, so forget about that. And he's like, okay, let's try the next thing. Oh, you must be mad, you know. And he was saying to me, I get these reports a lot about microwave attacks. And I was like, oh yeah, well maybe you should take it in, you know. It sounds like you've got a problem, you know. He's like, well, I do get them particularly in these autumn and winter months. I was like, it's March. You know, he's like, yeah, well, when it's very foggy here around Bern, I'm like, it's a sunny day. You know, it was ridiculous. He had to follow his protocol. You know, he had to say, and he was kind of gearing it towards depression, like, you must be depressed and therefore you are imagining these things. Mm. I was like, doesn't make any sense. And I looked at him and, you know, that didn't work. And he was getting ever more agitated. And then eventually he was like, okay, you know, step number four, he said, okay. And he kept saying, okay, at the end, you know, it's like, okay, this doesn't work. Let's try the next one. And eventually he said, okay, I understand these weapons exist and I understand that people are being attacked, but take it from me. We Swiss, we don't have microwave weapons. And I just burst out giggling. I was just giggling and laughing him in the face, you know.
It's terrific that he actually admitted it.
Yeah, he said we don't have microwave weapons. I was like, that's nonsense. I even said, you know, in front of him, I looked at him, I said, that's bullshit, and I was laughing.
He said these weapons exist, but we don't have them.
Yeah, he said, yes, I do know that these weapons exist, and yes, I've heard about them. I know they are called the non-lethal weapons, but here in Switzerland, we don't have them. I was like, how can you not? It's just 200 euros off the internet. Shall I get you one? You know, like, come on. This is nonsense.
Oh, but you have them in the Caribbean.
Yeah. Exactly.
They have them in the Caribbean, for Pete's sake.
Yeah.
And you think, how can it be that two adults are sitting across each other, we look each other in the eye, and this guy cannot snap out of it? Mm-hmm. You know?
You had, you know, I have to publish this list of your terminology, new terminology, which you call deprogramming from brainwash. And one of the things you'd mentioned was, you know, the intelligence agencies should really be called sabotage agencies. Yeah. And I thought, that's great. Yeah.
At this point.
Structured sabotage agencies, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And when you actually, you know, there was the other article recently in the UK that, I think the intelligence agencies wanted more and more power, even more power than they have now. And, you know, I just put out this tweet because when you have deprogrammed from this brainwash and you take, for example, MI6, which its official name now is Secret Intelligence Service, and you say, well, intelligence, any sort of intelligence on somebody is essentially either industrial or state level sabotage, because you take it away from them, you know, and you want to use it against them or somehow undermine them. That's sabotage. So any sort of intelligence is a form of sabotage, you know. I mean, you can use it to protect yourself, but hey, we know that's a very small fraction of what's going on. And then anything that's secret will eventually be criminal, you know. There is no reason to make something secret. There really isn't. And there's a systems analysis argument to say, well, if you want to have top-class defense, make all your problems public. If you think the Russians have developed, or the Chinese, something that you're scared of, like whatever black box device, just like as people found out with the hacking, if you've got a zero-day hack and you want a patch for that, or you want to find a zero-day hack, the best thing you can do is crowdsource your brains and put it public, make it public, and usually they find the answer within 4 hours, because some hacker somewhere who just happens to have worked on something similar will pick up on it. So the quickest problem solution is always the one that's pooling all the brains. Therefore, the quickest solution to any problem, even national security problems, is the most public and transparent one. By definition, there's a mathematical reason behind that. So given that that's the case, and I can't be the first, you know, systems analyst to figure this one out, why are things still secret? Of course, that's because tradition and people still haven't cottoned on to it. But I think also because a large things that all our governments have been doing have been criminal activities. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, war is the ultimate criminal activity, right? And it's what drives the entire industry, the entire military, intelligence, academic industry at this point is the war, the industry of war. And connected with that is the industry of surveillance.
Exactly.
Which brings us to the point that we are at today. You know, they need prey. They're acting as predators and they need prey. We are the prey.
Yeah, and we should really open our eyes. And when we've gone through this, I think the deprogramming is very important, because once you know intelligence equals sabotage, secret equals criminal, and you have suddenly a corporate logo, corporate, right? I'm sure MI6 is a corporation behind the scenes by now. You have a corporate logo saying secret intelligence service. You have to read, oh, criminal sabotage service. And then when they're asking for more money, you immediately know, is it a good thing if we give the criminal sabotage service even more money? The answer is pretty clear when you phrase it like that. It's like, no, no, that's a bad idea, especially when we've got austerity. We've got, you know, I don't know how many million people. I think a population the size of Spain on food stamps in the US. Do we need more money for these things? And already take the military intelligence complex. Military means attack. Intelligence means sabotage. So we've got the attack and sabotage complex. Is that a good thing? No.
Now, I mean, think of all of the money could have put any and everybody through college to even get a doctorate, and then put them in a house before they even started working. I mean, the amount of money being thrown down the toilet for a fake terrorist threat within the West, astonished. Have cured how many diseases? You could have extended how many people's lives with disease? You could have educated people to the hilt. You could have found how this person has, you know, the talent of this person is XYZ. We've got to put them in that area instead of letting them flounder as a janitor or something just because they came from a poor background. One thing that struck me, that if you want to coin something, you can go on the back of OCD. You can say organized civilization devolution is what they're engaged in. And it fits right with the obsessive compulsive disorder as well, because they are obsessively destroying any and all civilization that they can find. I mean, I've gotten contacted from people who are being targeted in Zimbabwe. Why in the world would you want to target somebody there? You know, what kind of national threat is somebody in Zimbabwe? I mean, we're not, you know, I mean, if I'm a national threat, then how is it that NSA basically ushered me on board and said, congratulations, here's a top secret clearance and let me work for 28 years. And then when I report something wrong, then I'm a national threat that needs to be stalked, harassed, and slow kill assassinated. Yeah. I don't think so, you know, because at that point, then you know the organization, your government, is a crime syndicate, you know, and nobody, people can't say, oh, I'm going to keep quiet and hope that this doesn't come for me. It's coming for you, you know, because you may wear pink on the wrong day, or your child may take a banana sandwich to school, and that's it for you. You know, it's coming for you. So for the people who don't think they're targeted, Ramola's right, you are targeted. You're breathing the chemtrails, which some of the chemtrails have to do with aluminum and making sure you can't grow your own food, because Monsanto is taking out patents on food that will grow in aluminum soil. Mm-hmm. If you don't agree with the political party, then you don't eat. So you are being targeted. And some of these chemtrails are throwing Morgellons onto you. And you're basically absorbing them, and you are being penetrated by foreign technology or foreign to the body. So you are targeted. We're just at the forefront of being targeted and being shut up as some of the first people who are speaking out. They're saying, okay, let's kill them. They need to be quiet because all these other sheep are not catching on. So for those people who think they're safe and if they stay quiet, they're going to just be safe, you're not. You're going to watch your children and your grandchildren devolving into something that you won't recognize as human, because mm-hmm. you've got to do something now. You've got to listen. You've got to take it seriously, or your family ends this century, because everybody's family ends this century. I mean, there is proof that all of these electromagnetic radiation emanations and things like that, they're destroying DNA. And right now they're worried that a certain disease, and I forget what disease it is, but it's from a mosquito, there, women are coming out and bearing children that are DNA blobs. They're barely human. And so they're afraid that this disease is doing it. Well, what if it's not that? Mm-hmm. What if it's in an area where they have all of these electromagnetic radiation weapons going off, hitting people right and left? I mean, when we are followed by... Pardon?
A pesticide. Pesticides.
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yes. Let's say you've got 5 or 10 targets in your city, and then these scumbags, these mercenary scumbags, basically are given some of these devices to put in their cars and powered by the car engine, and you're being followed by somebody who's cooking you. Well, when somebody pulls in front of the two of you, or it was somebody pulls in between, do they turn it off? No, they shoot through that person. They don't care if there's a newborn baby in that car. Mm-hmm. So everybody in town, when there are targeted people in the town, everybody in town is getting targeted by electromagnetic radiation of some kind, microwave, ultrasonics, which also will burn you. A sound at a certain level will actually burn you. So everybody around you is being targeted when anybody is being targeted. And people, that's something people have got to wake up and understand. They need to listen. Mm-hmm. Because if they don't want their grandchild to be a, that can't, you can't even tell that it was human, then they, you know, they just need to listen now. Mm-hmm. Because this is an extinction event on the horizon.
This is genocide on a mass scale. This is depopulation.
Magnetic environment, period. And I'm off my soapbox for the moment.
No, I absolutely think everything you said is right, and you are 100% correct. And the only thing I can add to that is that if you actually map out the trajectory, it's almost like a mathematical curve. This is a hockey stick. And, you know, there are certain feedback mechanisms. For example, when your children are damaged, they don't have the capacity to raise your grandchildren. You know, when you end up with one autistic child in the family, I think the total cost to raise an autistic child is like $1.5 million or something like that, you know, because of the extra care and extra this and that you need. And autism is rocketing. It seems that it's because of a combination of vaccines and, you know, aerosol spraying and all that. And when you have that, what you also have is these feedback mechanisms, because when a family has to look after a child, you've got fewer workers. You know, the brainiest person in a couple will actually look after the child because it is actually so demanding. So you will also deplete your trained population. And when you do that, what you do is you also hamper your own supply chains. And I was making the point that Agenda 21 sounds great when you're a psychopath and kind of like a top-down person at the top of the pyramid, when you don't really understand how your organization works. And I think most company leaders have no clue how their organization actually works, the vast majority, because it's just too complex. It's a self-assembling system. Most companies don't know who their valuable employees are. But Agenda 21 is a classical top-down management psychopath's wet dream. You know, it's like, hey, we're so powerful, we can just decide to kill somebody. We just put out a paper and then we just kill 2/3 of the population, whatever they were planning. But if you do that, you will essentially kill off your own supply chains. And now every single item, every phone, every toaster consists of thousands of actual components which are manufactured by specific, highly specialized companies. You know, you cannot possibly kill so many people and hope that there will be one toaster still working. It won't. It simply will not. And this is one of these things that, you know, at some point you don't notice. And then when you do notice, you've passed the point of no return, and then you're just tumbling. Because the autism rates are, I think, global, certainly in the countries where there's geoengineering, which I think might be another psyop. It might be genocide engineering, you know. And I wanted to make the point that when you have these nonlinear systems, the amount of time left you have to act also decreases nonlinearly. And the classic example is an atom bomb. You know, you have lots of time when the atom bomb is being put together. You can stop it. You can have proliferation agreements and so on. When the atom bomb is put into place, you still have plenty of time. But when the nonlinear part of the chain reaction kicks in, you might have a microsecond and then everybody's dead. Everybody's dead in a 50-kilometer, you know, circumference around the atom bomb. Well, you know, a radius of 50 kilometers. Well, that's nonlinear, right? Before, you had all the time in the world to discuss and have, you know, UN meetings. But when the atom bomb kicks in, you've no time, you're dead. And this is essentially, it's with atom bombs, we understand this now. But with anything else, like the ecosystems, like geoengineering or genocide engineering and these complex supply chains, our so-called leaders, or rather cartel holders, do not understand this. They're still going on about Agenda 21 or Agenda 2050 or whatever they are throwing around. These people are mentally ill. They're not systems analysts. They're not mathematicians. They are just mentally ill. That's it. We're listening to essentially Fred and Rose West or Jack the Ripper, you know, fantasize about his next killing spree. That's all nice and well. You know, we can do that if we're studying psychopathology and they're in an asylum. But when this stuff pours out of people and they're essentially have the levers of power, that's time to act for absolutely everybody. And I really think, you know, Karen, you just essentially put your point on the issue here. It's about time. We're now, this is now a question of time, and we don't have time anymore on so many levels, because people are trying to start World War III. You know, China and Russia are getting impatient with us. And Karen made a very good point on Ella's call that we were, you know, on. She said, well, if we don't tidy it up, and Russia tidying it up, that will be ugly. But those countries know this has to be tidied up, you know. And we have to do it now. And as a systems analyst, I'm telling everybody we don't have time. And now we might have 6 months to stop it. But in 3 months' time, we might only have 2 weeks to stop it, you know.
And, you know, the other issue, the point you made, Karen, about generations, yeah. You know, your families are being brought to an end. Your ancestral families, every one of your ancestral families on this planet are being brought to an end, whether with your generation, as with targeted individuals, or with the next generation, with your children or with your grandchildren. Why? Because we're a bunch of Kabbalistic, Satanist, transhumanists, and we've decided to pump you and your children up with nanotechnology. We're cyborging the whole lot of you. We're mind-having the whole lot of you, and we're mind-controlling the whole lot of you. So your children will not have a thought of their own in their heads, because we're even figuring out how to replace human will with a brain chip. So we're taking over, and this is the outer edge of that takeover. So you know that is absolutely right. And so this is another reason why people need to understand that who we are, who are being avidly and overtly targeted to the extent that everybody knows, well, we're telling everyone as well, we're just the outer edge. We're just the lip or the tip of what's coming and what's already happening to everybody else on the planet. You're either going to be genocided out of reality, or you're going to be cyborged into the new transhumanist reality.
That was
the living dead.
That was great. I need to jump in here because we're getting toward the end, and I don't know whether would they cut us off after 2 hours or whatever. So why don't you just, this has been a brilliant conversation beyond my wildest dreams. I think they picked three of the wrong people to target.
We hope so.
I'm sure so. So why don't we just sum up, and then we'll say goodbye and put this in the can. This was brilliant, ladies. This was brilliant. So why don't we just sum up, go from one to the other, and then we'll end. Go ahead. Katherine, why don't you start?
Okay, so I just briefly, I want to say that next time maybe we should also record the audio, because I've just seen a message that portions of our conversation have been cut out, and we will not be silenced. We will all record our audio, and if we have to put in the audio stream separately, we shall, you know, so there are ways around this. Then to sum up, you know, I think today we've really identified the problem. We've also introduced that, yes, there is a joint investigation group, and we encourage everybody to have their own joint investigation groups. Get together with the people you trust. Try to do something. Put out your results and how you did it to encourage others so that we have this multiplication effect. And I think now that we've identified the problem, I mean, now I'm going to work flat out and just spend all my time reporting on what to do about it and, you know, what I've learned and how to do it better. So essentially that's it from me. You know, I've now stated the problem in clearest terms, and now I'm just flat out on trying to solve it.
Oh, that's great, Katherine. Yes, thank you so much, Paul and Mindy, for having this forum. And, you know, I'm really glad that we were part of it today. And it's great because it was pretty much a free fall conversation and it went a lot of places. And I think we covered a lot of ground, which is great. So, you know, I think we could always probably get together and talk about how gruesome this problem is, you know, how infinitely horrific this targeting is. But I think it's also important, as you said, Katherine, to focus on the solutions and to focus on what we can do. So with this joint investigation team that we've started, I think we can each begin to start working in our own ways to make information available to other people, you know, like perhaps get a separate blog online, you know, maybe just a WordPress blog, and start throwing documentation on there for people, and links to other websites, because there are so many wonderful people who have been wrongfully targeted around the world who have set up wonderful websites with great information. So, you know, create links, create hubs and so forth online. So I look forward to that over the next few weeks, hopefully.
Thank you, Ramola.
Well, if I have one last thing to say, it's advice to people as to how to broach this subject with people who are not overtly targeted. If they care about nature, if they care about the purity of the food that they eat, then start talking this up as well, because they know very well that if they put their plants in a certain place in the house, maybe next to some kind of electrical field, the plant is not going to thrive. So they know that they're not either. And there is a lot of concern about these smart meters. And so you can piggyback on top of that and say, well, you know, you're already exposed to all kinds of electronic fields, and you know that's bad for you. How about if we tell you that some people are being exposed even more, and it's malicious and it's on purpose? And then you tell them to look into that, and then you can broach the subject of the fact that there are thousands of people on the watch list, and it may not seem like it's connected at the time, but you can also broach it by saying there are thousands of innocent people purposely put on the watch list. In fact, I made my own bumper sticker just ad hoc. I went to a store and got one of those magnetic vent covers that have a white side. I took magic marker and I put a couple on the back of the car that said thousands of people are being put on the terrorist watch list on purpose as a money-making scam. And I actually had people taking pictures of the back of my car.
That's fabulous.
There are all kinds of things you can get the word out. Some of the stalking that I experienced in Florida, I put a link to one of the first articles that I contributed to. And it was a very short link, and people were sitting behind me at stop signs and red lights and looking it up. And then you could see on their face, they'd look and go like, oh my God, you know? So there are things you can do, but like I said, when you start talking about this, get everybody involved first, and then you can funnel down to the fact that, yes, you know what you're talking about because you're a victim, but you give them the overall picture that they're in. Because people are selfish, people are lazy, they have things to do, they're worried about the Cub Scout meeting, they're worried about the dance recital and things like that, and they don't want to be bothered. But you need to tell them why they need to be bothered. And so this is a good umbrella way to bring it home to them, I think, and point them to Ramola's articles and her site and things like this. Say, go listen to this. That's how to engage the more people, and not just people who are targeted, but we need the voices of people who are not, but they're very concerned because they know or they suspect they could be targeted next.
That's brilliant, Karen, really brilliant. And I want to say, to add to that, this will be online almost immediately, I think. Immediately?
Mm-hmm.
It'll be immediately online and available. You can upload it onto your sites. Anybody else out there that is subject to this program, I'm hesitant to use the word targeted now, but is subject to this program, you can put it on your website too, link it in, and we'll be back up doing this again next week, God willing, and have our participant. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Well, I'll just add that I've been watching the chat room, and we have about 32 people in the chat room right now, everyone communicating. 34. And they've been adding to the conversation, but not really possible to interject what they've been saying. And a lot of people who are also at the effect of this torture program as well. So everyone is very appreciative, ask that we do it again.
You know, actually, one idea before we wrap up, if there's any, you know, really good points that we couldn't cover, we can always just take them up next week so people don't feel that their good points are left, you know, dropped off.
That's a really good idea. I did notice in our practice session, and I'm not exactly sure, I'm not very familiar with Google Hangout chats, but after the fact, when it was just archived, the chat room was gone. It wasn't possible to access. So that may be something that's only available while we're live and then it disappears. But if I can capture it all, I'll do my best to do that.
Yeah, maybe what one can do in those situations is do a screen capture, and then, you know, you can just capture the image you see doing a screenshot. You know,
that's a good idea. I'll actually do that right now. Okay, go back to the beginning.
Okay, I'm going to sign up.
Well, is there anything else?
Anything else that we need to wrap up?
Thank you all so much. This was so helpful.
Such
a brilliant conversation, and I think really helpful to a lot of people, and not just now while it's live, but ongoingly since it'll stay up on YouTube.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, because we have to thank you for setting this up. This was your idea, and essentially you're doing an organization, and thank you so much, because I would have never dreamt about the technology being just so fantastic. You know, thank you so much for doing the introduction for us.
You're welcome, and a lot of thanks go out to David Beverly. Jesus Free Computer Geek is his name on YouTube, but he's been incredibly helpful to teach us how to use this, and we appreciate you, David. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
And thank you all so much.
Plan on next week about the same time. We'll try to do it next week. If we do it consistently, I think we'll get an audience. A bigger audience than 34. Although 34, I'm happy. 34.
Yeah.
Well, you have to count the YouTube viewers later as well, you know, so it's always more.
We'll get thousands.
So count all the Intel agents will be watching this.
Yes, they need to hear first. They need to listen first.
I hope they've learned something.
And you can count on personal comments being from them. Yeah. They generally are.
Generally,
very unkind.
Maybe we should make a habit out of emailing the link to this YouTube video to MI5 and the NDB. You know, it's like for your...
Excellent. Let's tweet it out.
Okay. Yeah. Tweet it out. You know,
CIA, the NSA, DARPA.
Yeah.
MI5, MI6, BND.
We should have an email list for them, you know? We should. The victim email list, the perpetrator email list, you know?
Okay.
All right. Bye then.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye.
Can we put the end on?
You want to do that right now?
I can play the music,
but here it is. Why can't you play music? I don't know. I'm looking for the letters to play. Mm-hmm. I guess I'll just stop.
Okay.